here today to do the BookTube Booker tag, and I realised I haven't done a tag in quite some time. I was tagged to do this tag by Kendra Winchester, and it was started by David over at The Poptimist, and as soon as Kendra tagged me, I knew I had to do this tag because I just think it is such a fun, unique tag that I actually felt a desire to answer those questions and get involved in the discussion. But the inspiration behind this tag is obviously the Man Booker tag. But instead of being a traditional literary award where judges select what they believe represents the best of literature in that country or in that language that year, David came up with the idea that perhaps BookTube might have some opinions. You know, we are all avid readers, whether we are watchers or video creators on BookTube. And as well as reading books that came out 100 years ago, we are also reading the books that are coming out now. And it would be interesting to see what, as a group, we would pick for our best kind of books of 2018. So the preference here is that you pick books that came out in 2018 or late 2017 for your answers. But if you don't have books from 2018 or late 2017 that fit into the categories, you can still answer these questions with whatever your favourite book is of that category, even if it came out 50 years ago. And if you don't make videos, you can fill out David's survey, which he's also conducting via Google Form, so he can collect more data. And I'm assuming nearer the end of the year, he's going to share with us what came out of it. So I will link all the information down below, but without further ado, here are my answers for the BookTube Booker tag. So the first question is one where my answer is actually exactly the same as David's, and that is your favourite fiction book of the year. And my favourite fiction book of the year was Circe by Madeline Miller. Now, books that came out in 2018 this year that I read, which was actually a fair few I realised when I was looking back at what I've been reading, my favourite has to be Circe by Madeline Miller. That book was just absolute perfection for me. It is Madeline Miller's second ancient Greek myth retelling, and it's been quite a while since her last one came out, so it was quite a big deal that she had a new book coming out, and I hadn't tried any of her writing before, but I am so pleased that I did because I fell madly in love. This book retells the myth of the goddess Circe, who is also a witch, and kind of collects together all the different myths involving Circe and creates one long narrative of her life from childhood through the various different events that she's involved in from her perspective, and it is just so, so wonderful. It is so well structured, strung together, it flows effortlessly, and I just thought Circe was such a fascinating character to follow and get her perspective on things. Madeline Miller is a beautiful writer. She has an amazing way with prose, and that completely came through in this book. I actually had the privilege of interviewing Madeline Miller for my podcast as well, so if you'd like to hear that interview, I will link it down below, but that is definitely my favourite fiction book of 2018 so far. Next up is your favourite non-fiction book of 2018 or late 2017, and my favourite non-fiction book that I read that came out in 2018 this year was Misogynation by Laura Bates. The True Scale of Sexism. This is Laura Bates' third book, although it's her second book kind of aimed at adults, so her second book that she released was more aimed at young adults. And her first book was Everyday Sexism, which was inspired by a project that she started by the same name that collects together men and women's experiences of everyday sexism, shares them online, kind of gives people an opportunity to share their experiences but also recognise that they're not alone in their experiences, and demonstrates the kind of pervasiveness of this everyday sexism, which goes from, you know, catcalling in the street to not being hired because you might potentially get pregnant one day, or actually suffering sexual abuse. Now, this book is a collection of Laura Bates' essays that were previously published in newspapers, and they've just been sort of collected together in this one volume, which I really like. I kind of like seeing all those essays together because you get the strands that come through consistently, and it really packs a punch. And there is also a bit of a focus on this book in particular on the media. So perhaps because these were articles published in the media, a lot of them deal with different strands of media and how media promotes sexism, or how certain media formats or media outlets have been sexist, have perpetuated sexism in various different ways. And I like that it kind of had that kind of overarching theme, and I thought the essays made a really interesting collection altogether. We then have favourite debut novel, which is something I've definitely read less of than, say, just standard novels that came out in 2018. But I do have a favourite debut novel that came out very late 2017, so I think it's acceptable. And it is an absolute favourite, it completely deserves to be here, and that is Nevermore by Jessica Townsend. This is actually a children's book, sort of for the same kind of age range as, say, Harry Potter, and it's had a lot of comparisons to Harry Potter, in that it is this really absorbing, detailed world that you completely fall into, and I think would appeal to readers of all ages. I mean, I'm 26 and I loved it, and I know lots of other adults who have read and loved this series, but as well I'm sure children would adore it. I know I would have adored this as a child, but it is a really intricately built world. It does not sort of lack anything for being a children's book. It is packs as much into it as any adult book could. It just has a lot of the fun that you expect from a children's book, which is really nice, and that kind of real imagination that seems to be typical of good children's fantasy. And this book follows Morrigan Crowe, who's a young girl who is cursed to die on her 11th birthday. However, as midnight strikes on that night, instead of dying, a man named Jupiter comes and whisks her away to Nevermore, where she is given the opportunity to apply to the Wondrous Society, which is a society that Jupiter is a member of, and she just has to pass some certain tasks to get into it. So she has to like complete all these different quests and tasks, and she meets new people, and just the characterization is so fun. They're really eccentric characters, really interesting characters, and I really just love this story, and the sequel's coming out this month, which I cannot wait for. So that's going to be another excellent 2018 book, but as a debut goes, this is just perfection. We then have favourite poetry collection. Now, this poetry collection came out in 2017 in the US, but it came out in 2018 in the UK. So that is Don't Call Us Dead by Denez Smith. If you don't already, go and follow them on Twitter and Instagram, because they are so entertaining. My friend Jen recommended that I follow them on Instagram, and I do not regret that decision one bit. She also is the one that recommended this poetry collection to me, and I also don't regret picking it up one bit. This is a collection of poetry, and it's incredibly, incredibly moving, difficult, beautiful, all of these things. It deals with various different things. It deals with being queer. In particular, it deals with being HIV positive, which isn't a theme I have seen tackled a lot in poetry that has kind of made it to the mainstream. This has won some awards. A lot of people are talking about it. So I think that it deals with some really incredibly important topics in a really personal and moving way. It also deals with sex, relationships, racism, loads packed into here, and it is well worth all the hype it has been receiving. I will definitely be picking up more of Denez Smith's poetry in the future. We then have favourite translated work. So this book did not come out first in 2018, it came out in French originally in 2013, but was published in 2018 in English by Europa, and that is A Winter's Promise by Christelle Dabos. This is stunning. Look at this book. This is just like one of my favourite covers of the year as well, but not the favourite cover, because that is one of the questions. But it is stunning, and it is beautiful inside as well. In fact, if you liked Nevermore, you will enjoy this. It is aimed at a slightly older audience than Nevermore. It's more in the young adult category, but it's one of those books that really, again, will appeal to people of all different ages. A bit like His Dark Materials. It's been compared to His Dark Materials a lot, and I think that's because it's an intricately built world. It's very cold, and it has that kind of agelessness to it. And I'm so pleased that this has been translated into English. So I'm really pleased that Europa picked this up, because they don't usually publish young adult literature, but I think they definitely made the right call in making this their first YA book. It is a fantasy novel, it's the first in a series, and I can't wait for the next ones to come out in English. I think book two comes out in 2019. And it follows our protagonist Ophelia, who has been betrothed to a man from another city in their kind of fantasy world, who she doesn't know, doesn't want to marry, but doesn't have any choice, and she is taken away with him to his home, which is incredibly different from her own. Each of the cities in this fantasy world, you know, have their own system. They're all descended from different kind of spirits, But they've kind of taken on lives of their own in the way that their cities work, and this city is very different from our own. People are far less familiar with one another, they are far more suspicious of one another, there is a lot of political intrigue going on. She doesn't know who to trust in this new place that she finds herself with no friends, surrounded by strangers apart from her aunt, who is her sort of chaperone. With a man she doesn't particularly want to marry, and it turns out she is being used as a political pawn. So it's all about her figuring out who she can trust and what's going on, and kind of observing things in the background whilst trying to stay hidden, and it's just wonderful. Next up is favourite comic book or graphic novel, and I actually have to say, sadly, I haven't been reading a lot of graphic novels or comic books in 2018, let alone ones that came out in 2018. I've really read very few, but over the past few weeks I've started reading more comic books again, and one of them did come out in 2017, so I thought I would mention that, and it is Snot Girl Volume 1. I wanted to pick this one up after I saw Monica over at She Might Be Monica talk about it, and read the blurb and just thought it sounded hilarious. It is kind of the kind of cutesy drawing style, but also like obviously very artistic, that I've kind of come to love when it comes to comic books. And this is just an incredibly, what I think is, satirical comic book series, and I can't wait to pick up volume 2. It is about a social influencer, a famous fashion blogger and Instagrammer named Lottie Person, who is this young woman who has the seemingly perfect life when it comes to aesthetics. She has a massive following online, she looks gorgeous all the time, except she has terrible allergies that nobody can know about, because when she actually goes out into the world, she ends up like this big snotty mess, and it ruins her image or whatever. But I think that's just sort of an example. It's just like a kind of slightly, it's an example that you can kind of laugh at and sympathise. A lot of us have different allergies. With her, while still kind of pointing out that you don't always know what's going on in the background of people's lives. And I really like Lottie, because although she had this seemingly perfect life from the outside, she was full of anxieties, so she was really struggling with kind of feeling at ease around other people. She wasn't sure who her friends were, she felt incredibly insecure, and who can't relate to feeling insecure and anxious? Come on, we've all felt that to varying degrees in our lives. So you kind of got to see the behind the scenes of what was going on in Lottie's head, and I really enjoyed that, but at the same time it was really funny, and there's also a bit of a mystery running through it, which I think is just going to escalate given what happened right at the end of this. So you get a bit of a mystery, some laugh out loud moments, just a great fun comic book. I know it has a bit of mixed opinions, but I thought it was quite satirical and interesting, and I enjoyed it, so I'm looking forward to volume 2. But I did mention I'd be talking about my favourite book cover as well, and that's the next question. So my answer to that is also a Greek myth retelling, and it's The Silence of the Girls by Pat Barker. Just look at it, look at it. I mean, this is about favourite cover, so let's just stare at it for a moment. Beautiful, continues to be beautiful, and then beautiful end papers. Tick, 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 everything about this book is perfect, but it's also beautiful inside. I wouldn't mention a book that had a beautiful cover that I hadn't enjoyed the book as well. This is also one of my favourite fiction books of the year. It retells essentially Homer's Iliad, although we do kind of hear about events after the Iliad, so it covers more than just the Iliad covers, but it centres on the same characters and the same primary event, which is the Trojan War. But from the perspective of Briseis, or Briseis, however you want to pronounce it, and she is one of the Trojan women who is enslaved by the Greek soldiers during the war and becomes the concubine, like forced sex slave of Achilles, the Greek hero, and it's following her perspective on the war, her experience of the war as a woman, and it is so heart-wrenching yet beautifully rendered. I actually also had the honour of interviewing Pat Barker on my podcast, although that episode's not up yet. It will be on the 29th of October, I believe. So if you are like following my podcast online, you will hear about it when it comes out. But look at the cover, absolutely stunning. Published by Hamish Hamilton, which is an imprint of Penguin Random House. And the artwork itself is by Sarah Young. So hats off to Sarah Young. She has really captured the beauty, yet kind of sadness of the inside of this book, and I think the colours are gorgeous, the illustrations are gorgeous, and I would honestly have this as a piece of artwork on my wall. We then have favourite author 2018, but the idea behind this question isn't that you pick an author whose book you really enjoyed this year, it's somebody that you've enjoyed their presence online of. So say it's an author who is active on social media or has a website that you find really engaging or really important, or who writes articles for newspapers or magazines that you have enjoyed. So somebody that's kind of been active in 2018 outside of just writing a book that you would recommend other people follow, essentially. And I've gone for somebody who, I don't know if you'd say are an author in the loose terms, but they did have their debut book come out this year. It's just that it's a cookbook. So I'm showing you this because it came out this year, officially making Jack Munro an author. Number one best-selling author, in fact. And this is Cooking on a Bootstrap, which is her cookbook all about budget cooking. And I've made a few things from this. It is absolutely fantastic, really straightforward, affordable, but tasty meals. And I think Jack Munro is somebody you should definitely be following online. Not just for recipes, because she does share recipes on her website and she's planning on starting a YouTube channel, but because she is so, like, politically active on social media, which is something I appreciate in people I follow. And she discusses really, like, in-depth and from personal experience, the experience of poverty and living below the poverty line in the United Kingdom, about kind of how low-income families, single-parent families, people struggling to find jobs have really been let down by the country. And she's not only constantly talking about these things, bringing them to light, kind of engaging with a very large audience that she has and not shying away from these issues, she also talks about her own experience as well as kind of does some amazing stuff. I think she's just fantastic and you should definitely follow her on Twitter at least. Second to last, we then have favourite BookTube video, and I have gone for a three-part video, but they follow on from one another. They essentially make up one large video, but it's in three parts, and that is Rose Maring's Starving Girls in Victorian Literature video series. So this year, Rose did something on her channel that I just thought was absolutely fantastic. I found really inspirational, made me want to try and do some content like that, although I haven't got around to it yet. And that is, she adapted her master's dissertation into a three-part video series that was accessible to a wider audience. Victorian literature is by no means something I'm an expert in. I've read a few pieces of Victorian literature, but I probably would have found actually reading a dissertation on the topic quite intimidating, and I wouldn't have necessarily had enough background knowledge. But she did this wonderful three-part series where she discussed the topic of her dissertation, which was starving girls in Victorian literature. How they appear in Victorian literature, what they mean, what it tells us about Victorian society, in a really accessible yet still academic manner. So it was really informative, yeah, I feel like anybody could watch it and enjoy it, and I just found it a fascinating subject. It was something I didn't know anything about, and I loved watching Rose talk about it, and I'm so pleased she made that three-part video series. And I would just highly recommend you all go and check it out, whether you are a massive fan of Victorian literature or not. I think you will find this three-part series really interesting. It's divided into kind of three separate topics that are really nice and bite-sized. And yeah, just absolutely fascinating. I've been recommending it to a lot of people in real life. So if you haven't watched it already, please do go check it out. Rose is a fantastic BookTuber and I thought she did a wonderful job. And lastly is favourite new to you BookTuber, so a BookTuber that you started following this year. And for that I wanted to mention Badger Reads, or Huck, who is a young woman making BookTube videos and has nowhere near as many subscribers as she deserves, because her channel is absolutely fantastic and I would encourage you all to go and check it out. But I actually found Huck's channel because of one of your guys' recommendations. So I've been reading a lot of fantasy this year, high fantasy authors like Juliet Morilli, and someone commented saying, if you like Juliet Morilli, have you checked out Huck's channel? Because she also loves Juliet Morilli. So I instantly went over there because I hadn't seen anybody else talk about Juliet Morilli on BookTube, and fell in love with her channel, because not only does she read Juliet Morilli, who's one of my favourite fantasy authors, she reads so many other fantasy books I don't see talked about elsewhere. Obviously she reads books I have heard of and have seen other places, but I also feel like I'm constantly being exposed to new fantasy books on her channel, which I appreciate incredibly, and I just trust her opinion from what I've watched now of her videos. I feel like I agree with her on lots of things when it comes to novels, and I think she just has a wonderful way about her, she's really enjoyable to watch. You know, all of the things you want from a YouTube channel, tick, tick, tick. And again, like I said, I think so many of you would enjoy her, so I would really, really encourage you to go and check out her channel. Whether you're a big fantasy nerd or not, she has loads to share with you. She's also got a gorgeous Instagram feed, so if you're looking for more gorgeous Bookstagram feeds to follow, I will also link that down below. But those are all of the questions for the BookTube Booker tag. If you do want to answer this, you can either film a video, consider yourself tagged by me. I would love to see your responses, so do let me know if you do it. Or if you don't want to make a video, I will link David's Google form down below that you can fill out for yourself. I'd also love to hear your answers in the comments to my video, and we can chat about what you think the best books of 2018 and late 2017 have been, what has really stood out to you and impressed you, and also let me know your favourite BookTube channel of the year so I can go and check them out. Thank you. Until next time, happy reading, and I'll see you all again soon. Bye.